this is a work, joint work with Yala, that is part of the development of this Statebox project infrastructure. This is a startup with a very questionable aesthetics. Someone even asked me if it was real. I said, this is a real thing. Yeah, it's very real. And what we do is we basically use... This is really suboptimal. Okay. So yeah. So we basically use patchnets to do software, to do programming. So
yeah, I will stay here.
Okay. So what is a patchnet? A patchnet is a model for concurrent computation that consists of places that represents resource types, transitions that are processes that consume resources and spit out other resources, and tokens that inhabit places and are the things that flow around processed by transitions. So you can see a patchnet graphically like this. So what this means is you have a token in X, so you have a resource of type X and a resource of type Y. Now this thing needs to get one resource of type Y to give you one resource of type X and one resource of type Z. This thing needs two. So this thing at the moment can't do anything because you don't have enough here. And this thing can, again, process. Since this is basically a theory about resources, transitions have to compete to fire. So for instance, if this thing fires, this thing is stealing the token from here. So now this thing will need to wait even more to get tokens. So you can see mu firing now. When mu fires, I get two tokens in X and one in Z. Then I can fire tau, for instance. So we want to keep track of the flow of tokens in a net if we want to do programming with this thing. The reason is that, as I say, transitions correspond to processes, so algorithms that consume terms of a data type and speed up terms of a... This was...
Yeah,
expected.
It's Mac, Mac just.
Okay. And speed term of a data type. Yeah, that... Never again. Basically, and the reason why we want to do this is because clearly, if I have like two tokens here that have different histories, and I want to fire mu, I have to know on which token mu is acting. I have to distinguish between these things. So the way we do it is using category theory. This is nothing new. This has been done by Vladimiro Sassone and other people. But the idea is that to each patternet you can associate a symmetric model category where places are generating objects, states of the net, so distributions of tokens, become monodal products of these objects, and transitions become families of generating morphisms. Families is because when you do it in practice, there is a lot of bookkeeping to do, but intuitively, this is the idea. Downside, on the bottom, I have the category, the string diagrams in my category, and that's the patternet. So at the moment, I have a resource of type X, and then I fire tau. So tau takes resources of type X and gives me two resources of type Y. Then I can fire mu, and I can decide on which one mu is firing. So now it's firing on, I can literally see which token mu is taking in. Then I can apply nu, for instance. I can fire mu again up there, and I can fire tau again. But you know, like now, this thing at the bottom, I can literally turn these things into pieces of Haskell code or something similar. I have data types, and I can execute this algorithm. So okay, what this paper is about is what happens if we have negative tokens. First things that we notice that with negative tokens that are represented as red dots here, I don't know if you can see them, but basically you can get tokens out of thin air, like in figure B, because the idea is that a negative token and a positive token should annihilate with each other. We can generalize nets in two ways. The first one is we take standard nets, and we just allow for negative tokens. The second one is that we also allow negative numbers on the edges. So now a net can consume negative tokens or spit out negative tokens and whatever. So a thing that happens crispy immediately is that now transitions can always fire. Even if this needs two and I only have one, a transition can make a dent using this thing and can fire. Now, why is this stuff useful? Okay, I'll get to that later, but we want to represent this categorically. And the idea is very easy. You just have a cup and a cap that represents these couples of tokens annihilating or appearing out of nowhere. Then we proved that basically, each integer patronet can be linked to a particular free strict compact close category, modulo some other axioms. And we proved that there is an adjunction between the category of patronets, that is basically patronets and morphisms described, formalized in a suitable way, and these compact close categories and functors between them. And this thing gives us an equivalence. So for each patronet, I can have a compact close category that represents all the possible ways of executing these nets. Each string diagram is a possible execution of the net. So now we can use this stuff to do something interesting. So the first thing that we note is that if we have a standard transition, like that one, tau, tau carries tokens from x to y, but it can go backwards with negative tokens. So the idea is that I start to y, in y, I produce a couple of token anti-token, I apply tau to x, and then I annihilate these things. And what I'm really doing is I'm moving this from here so the idea is that negative tokens flow backwards, basically. Why is this useful? You can use this stuff to represent real-life scenarios when you implement patronets. So now I'm going to say something that will horrify you, that is implementations. But yeah, this is basically what you need to do when you implement this stuff. So now imagine that this patronet on the left lives in a real network, and users can decide to fire transitions. But now the problem is that a user sees the net locally, decides to fire, and broadcasts this decision over the network. This thing can take time, and at the same time, user two can do the same, because it still needs to get the message from user one. And now the net is an overall illegal state, because you don't have two tokens there. So this can be represented, but using these negative tokens, you can, I don't know why it's, anyway, you can see that I can represent this putting a red dot in the middle. With this thing, we can represent legal and illegal states that get produced and destroyed. So for instance, up there I have a net in a legal state, and now I'm producing something illegal because I have a negative token in a place, so something has been fired too much. Down there, I'm doing the opposite. I have an illegal state, and I'm somehow destroying it, and I'm getting into a legal state now. Another interpretation for this stuff is economics. Places represent portfolios, so assets of different agents. Tokens are credit if they are positive, they are debit if it's negative, and transitions can turn credit into debit, and so on. In this case, what this transpose thing means is that giving money to someone equals buying their debt. So you can see this as X is making a debt to give Y money to repay Y's debt. So again, money flows forward, debt flows backwards, or in the opposite direction. The last thing I want to show you is how we can use all this stuff together and why it's useful for us. So imagine a situation of conflict resolution. I have this net, tau fires, so now the token is in Y, but I want to represent this idea that another agent now is firing noon, even if there are no tokens there, because of this broadcast time stuff I was talking about. You can represent this like this. Now, the interesting part is that if someone fires new, I can, again, put the net back into a legal state. What I'm doing categorically is represented here, but now I can use the Yanking equations to erase the illegal state for my net. So this is the flow of time. Tau happens, then nu happens, then mu happens, but I have illegal stuff in the middle. When I Yank, I can have a legal sequence that is tau mu nu. So the flow of the wire represents like the causal flow of the net without fuck ups, basically. And this is useful for a lot of things for us. We can use this stuff to model economic phenomena, or that's something we are working on. We can use this for consensus, because crypto consensus is exactly about many people having different views of the world and doing different things, and somehow you need to correct all these possible errors that spawn and all these possible conflicts that you have. And in this case, what happens is that this formalism reduces the amount of consensus that you need. Because at the moment, the only thing that I need is to know if nu has been fired before or of tau, to understand if the string diagram that I need is the one, is this one, or the one where this is y and this is y and this is x, basically. So, but in the end, I can basically reduce the amount of operations that I have to do to get consensus. Another interpretation for this thing is in terms of variables. So if you consider that tokens are terms, then this is basically a term that is not being initialized in any way. This thing is appearing out of thin air. So suppose that x is a type string. I don't know which string is this thing. I'm just creating it out of nowhere. But what I'm creating is also another thing that tells me I'm waiting for a value. When you will finally initialize this string, I will be able to concatenate this operation. And this is exactly what happens is, okay, some stuff happens. Oh, now I have a candidate for this string. I can say, okay, so I'm initializing this thing now, and I can concatenate these operations. Another interpretation, if you want to go economy-wise here, is imagine that X knows that the prices of something will fall down sharply in the future, and he really wants to make money because he likes money. So what X does is, first things first, it sells stuff to Y. Good. Things will go down, so he's sold at a profit, presumably. But he really wants to make money. So what he does is, he wants to short sell stuff. So what he does is, he basically produces a contract with Z. This is called going long on a put option. So what you do is, you produce a contract where you say, 5 days from now, I will give you this asset for this price, and you fix the price before. What happened? Is that?
No.
Okay, cool. Was I dead? So what happens now is, okay, X sells the asset to Z, and basically when then the price is full, that is here, X decides to honor the put option, and it basically makes a double gain. So these are only a few of the things we started doing with this integer patterns, but I think they can be very useful when you have to do actual implementations and use them to do actual software. I think that's more or less it.
Good.
Yeah, we have some programs if you want to see.
Great, right?
Thanks.